Okay, so today we have Dr. Desai with us from IGIB. As you know, he's an adjunct faculty with our center also, and he's also a professor in ACSR. He works in various areas related to proteomics, algorithm and tools development, high throughput data analysis of comparative genomics, and proteomics informatics. And he'll be talking to us today about how to use data analytics and data from biological data to search for missing human proteins. Okay. Thank you.
Okay. So, friends, let us analyze the topic in search of missing human proteins. So, what according to you, you think is missing protein? How do you say what is missing? A simple analogy is that missing students from this seminar. So, how do I go to the missing students? So, there has to be a register or a catalog, which would say that these are the students expected in this hall. And there is a catalog which says that these are the students which are present. So this minus that will give you the missing students. So in case of missing human proteins, so there is one expected proteins in the human. And there is one experimentally found set of proteins in human. And that is compared, the difference between the two sets are the missing proteins. Okay. So this is the topic I chose to tell you because this is one of the hottest area that people are working in this internationally, and that's why I chose this topic. But I must say that how many of you know about, let's say, proteomics or anything about how mass spectrometry? If it is not known, I have prepared few slides for that as well. So that, I mean, do you know any of, you say what you know, otherwise many of my talks will go over at projection. So proteomics jante hain, mass spectrometry suna hua hai, padha hua hai? Yes. Okay. So in that case, I have made two presentations. I will take you to the other one, which instead of take you to the missing human protein story. If you are following up scientific literature, there are nearly 20,000 protein coding genes, and there is a project called Chromosome Centric Human Proteomic Project. Hope you have heard of. This is a highly talked up project. So like human genome sequence was done in 2001, which was a high. And similarly, the human proteome project is also another high in the protein direction. And these are couple of projects which are attacking this problem of knowing the entire proteome of human. And all these efforts, all these global efforts, even has not given us the required of all the genes, that all the proteins that we have in a human cellular system. So, something about Human Proteome Project. It is a project, international project, organized by WHO, and three pillars. It has three main objectives: mass spectrometry based methods, antibody based methods, and knowledge based. These are the three pronged approach using which they are looking for the protein content of a human cell, cellular system. Completion of this project will enhance the understanding of human biology. That's what they pose.
So, one simple question is that, like, we use microarray, we use basically something like
for the nucleotides and the RNA expression.
RNA expression. Right? Mm-hmm. So, those are all the big data where huge data can be simultaneously extracted by performing one single experiment. Mm-hmm. But with the mass spectrometry and the antibody tagging and all this, how big the data will be? Still, so,
mass spectrometry.
Highly accurate and precise compared to microarray. What is the amount of data that which you will generate, and simultaneously how many protein protein interactions you can actually use?
Right. So the current state of technology that we have, the mass spec based proteomics gives you millions of spectra in one experiment. But how things are happening is like this: you take the cellular extract, then you fractionate it using LC, and in the fractionation process, different sizes of the protein first get fractionated, then you process each of the fraction, or these, all these things happen automatically, and then get injected into the mass spec machine, okay, and what you get is finally the each of the fractions corresponding peptides or protein, depending on top-down approach, bottom-up approach, whichever approach you are taking, you are getting the cellular content in the in terms of the proteins from the cellular system. So it is a high throughput method of detecting the proteins. Microarray, on the other hand, gives you the knowledge about the genes are getting expressed or not. That is the process of transcription. But we are talking about the translation. All transcribed products may not necessarily be translated. So what we will get to know from here is the translational state of each of the genes. Now, two major diversions, the Human Proteome Project has got two objectives, two major objectives. Describe all the elements of the human proteome and provide resources for identification and quantitation of proteins in the biological environment, networks and pathways in health and disease. So one is chromosome based human proteome project, CHPP, another is biology of the disease human proteome project. So these are the two major aspects of this human proteome project. Okay, so I will take you through this room now. Where I am going to take you is one of these efforts, one of these objectives. Missing protein, as I told you, missing protein is nothing but those proteins which are predicted to be encoded, predicted, mind you, by specific genes but lacking reliable protein expression evidences from mass spectrometry, antibody based detection, 3D structure, advanced sequencing. These are the few of the methods where if you get any information about the protein, then you say that to that protein is existing or not. According to the FUPO, 5 years ago, they tried to look for and quantify the so-called missing protein, and they said that 2,930 missing protein. This number, what you are seeing over here, will change as the date and time changes. Okay, so I have given you one such number, but as I go through the presentation, you will see that the number is changing. And why so, you will also realize soon. Missing protein in 2014. Is 2,948. This is sometime last year, 2016, 2,900. So, 18 proteins.
What is NextProt?
NextProt is a Swissprot. NextProt is a proteomic database, protein coding database, which is supposedly the reference. It is the unique protein sequence database, and they have the most annotated proteins of human, this next protein.
Similar to the
yeah, so they have named it like this, but it has come from Swissprot and all. So Swissprot has got everything. NextProt is focused about human protein and well annotated, well curated data is there.
So one question is like, what is the size of these proteins actually, and what sort of proteins
are these proteins? Size means in terms of dalton, kilodalton, you are talking about?
Yeah. How we classify in terms of your sizes, or what is that type of protein you are looking at? Is it a functional protein or unique protein?
Any protein that is getting translated in the human system are the protein that we are looking at. And size, it ranges from maybe 100, 200 amino acids to all the way to some several thousand amino acids. So we have all the ranges. So the point I was trying to impress upon you, that it may sound that okay, in 2 years time, nearly 2 years time, you got only 18 proteins. 18 proteins you have identified. That time you had 2,948, now you have 2,930. But that high, that steep is the competition right now. All the low-hanging fruits have already been eaten. Now the missing proteins people are identifying are really the rate at which you are expecting is really slow, and you have to do specialized experiments, you have to go to specialized conditions. Maybe these proteins are expressed in certain at certain time point, at certain stress conditions, we do not know. So these proteins you will see only when those kind of conditions are given to the human cellular system, therefore that those proteins will be expressed.
Sorry, I'm still actually lost in one thing. What do you mean? How do they know that these are the proteins that are missing?
How do I know these are the proteins? So that part of the presentation was in the other slide, but maybe I'll definitely tackle this point. Good question. Those are in the basic slides. Challenges in missing protein identification, because they could be low abundant. I told you that specific time and condition. And for that, that's why these slides are well thought process. First of all, it could be a low abundant protein. So protein is there, but it is not visible through the technique that we are talking about. Or it is expressed in specialized organs, testes, placenta, olfactory system, blah blah, all these things. So that could be another reason that it is in certain specialized tissues. It is a tissue-specific expression, it could be expression restricted to certain developmental stages. These are all temporal. This is special, this is temporal, or this is a condition that is stimuli. No triptic peptide, this is something very interesting. How do we detect protein? I may use a board. So the basic slide that I was missing, I will draw it over here. How do I detect protein? So this is a protein, okay? And then this protein is digested into peptides. So this is called peptic digestion. You can use any enzyme to digest. These are all peptides. These peptides are further put into an instrument called mass spectrometer. Okay, and thereby you will get something called a spectra. Okay. Now, on the other hand, what we do? We take the corresponding protein sequence on the computer. Are you there with me? And then this sequence these are on the bioinformatics side, computational biology. We create peptides, okay, theoretically. Each of these peptides, now we convert them into a spectra. Okay, so this is a theoretical spectra. And we compare this spectra with this spectra to evaluate. I tell that if this sequence, let's say this sequence is P, Q, R, S, T, okay, if this is the same thing or not. This is the entire process, okay. Now imagine here there are thousands of peptides, okay, and these thousands of peptides giving you several thousands of spectra, because each peptide will not give you one spectra. As they enter the machine, they will hit the detector, they will give you a spectra. So there are several thousands of spectra. And here, each peptide will give you one spectrum. Why? Because it's a theoretically created spectrum. Now, the molecular ion peak, say this is 1086. This is the molecular ion peak of PQRST. So, what we do, we ask a question, how many peptides are there whose molecular mass is 1086? Correct, students? You are with me? So, what will happen? PQRST will say, I am there. But simultaneously, this guy also will say that I am there. RST, PQ. This guy also will have the same mass. So, and similarly, hundreds of peptides with similar configuration, similar composition will say that I am there. All of them will compete for this spectra. But only one of them
will qualify with a higher score, because this, I forgot to mention, this is MS-MS, double mass. That means a peptide is further broken into its fragments, and that's how we are getting this. So PQ-RST will give you a spectra for PQ, then RST. It will give you a peak for PQR, followed by ST, so on and so forth. And all these peaks will be answered yes if this is the right peptide. These peptides will not answer all of them. Got it? So that's how we will get to know that if this is the answer or this is the, because the whole of it may explain this peak, but the parts of it will not explain the parts of this spectra. And that is where this guy will fail, this guy will qualify. Okay? Even if still it's not clear, I will make another attempt, but let me go through the main part. Okay, there you go. So, out of 20,000 odd protein that we have, 16,497 have credible protein level evidence. That means they are called PE1 level protein. They have other evidences, mass spec evidences or by experimental evidences that these proteins are existing. But then there is a huge lot of 3,564 proteins which we do not have transcript level evidence, we do not have homology based evidence, we do not have gene model level evidence. None of these actually we have. We have transcript level evidence, but still we do not have credible. So that is 2,600. We have homology based evidence of 214, but we still do not have other experimental aspect or other kind of evidence. So these all put together is 3,564. So what is internationally called missing protein is the sum of these plus these plus these three. To top it up, I have added this 616, which is called uncertain, absolutely uncertain protein. I have also included them into the missing protein. Why? Because I propose that why don't you think that the missing protein could come from here? So if we include, see, as you can see now it is reducing. 616 is now, if I go back, it is 586. So people are taking protein from this list and moving it up. And we are getting more and more evidence about that. So they are getting included. So this is for me is the list of missing proteins. Is that clear to all of you?
So how is this list created? P1, P2, P3?
So these are created because we have got a gene whose RNA-seq data tells that it has an expression. But the proteomics data, NextProt data, doesn't say that this protein exists here. So that is in this PE2. What is PE3? You take the gene, you do a blast, you get homology based evidence that this protein exists in rat, this protein exists in some other mouse or other organism. It is expressed also there. But the same gene we don't see in human being expressed. So that's why we have given him a placeholder and what in this category. Got it? So this is our approach at IGIP. We thought if we have to attack this problem, this is the best way to go. We have to first look for a database that is complete. So as you can see, the success of a proteomic search also is on this side. That is a theoretical protein sequence database. So we have to freeze the database. So for that, we have to compare multiple databases, and based on that, we focused on one single database, that is NextProt. So for us, the search space is NextProt sequences. Then we took the post-translational modifications. New concept maybe for some of you. Proteins get post-translationally modified. That is like, you can say phosphorylation, then other kind of groups get attached to the amino acids. So no longer the mass of P is P. The mass of P is P star. P plus the modification. So this kind of matching will not result in identification. So this post-transformer modification we need to include in our solution. Another is protease specificity and uniqueness of peptides. Many a times when you cut the protein at the ends using a peptide digestion and all, there is a formula, there is a standard rule that lysine or arginine, after that it will cut. So what if the rule is followed at one end and the rule is not followed at the other end? That is called semi-truth. In biology, sometimes it happens like that. So we have to allow semi-truthic search in our search space. And we also have taken a different search space for translated database. So this is what you saw is already a NextProt protein sequence database. And the translated database is a theoretical protein created from all the transcript level evidence. They have been translated and put into the database. So this is what is the four-pronged approach. I have this is my workflow. Database is frozen here, NextProt database. As I told you, there is a translated database created by taking the transcript level information. So there are various RNA-seq data available on the internet of human. You can take those and translate and create a database. And then, I also told you that semi-cryptic searches what we have included in our workflow, apart from standard searches. And searched with commonly encountered PTMs. All these things have been incorporated. Also, to top it up, we have taken a multi-algorithmic search engine, that is OMSA and Tandem. What is multi-algorithmic search engine? People will understand better than anybody else. That when people search, they search with a particular search engine. Now, what we do a collation of results from multiple search engines. So each of the search engines will give their result, and then we collate them. And then we process them together. So the sensitivity increases when you do like that, and the specificity also will increase. And finally, what you get is the PSM identity, the peptide spectra match information. So this is one application we have developed at IGIB. This is an in-house developed application. But the components, the cogs and wheels are taken from various open source algorithms. Not all of them. So anyone of you who have been who is aware of the RNA-seq data, so this past part, this is UGenosu, which we have developed integrated transcriptome proteomic pipeline, has got a transcriptome analysis pipeline included into this. And each of these boxes that you are seeing over here does one or the other job. So for example, takes the SRA toolkit, converts it into the FASTQ format. FASTQC does the QC quality check of the reads. As you can see, the quality is bad here, and after the QC, the quality has come to the green region. I don't know whatever I'm telling you of understanding, or somewhere I'm assuming things. So this is typical MGS analysis toolkit. So the red zone is a bad quality, orange zone is acceptable quality, green zone is good quality. So when you cream all of them, then you get a good quality reads. Once you get the good quality reads, then you process it further, and then you create a protein coding sequence. So my entire objective of doing all of them is to convert the DNA sequence, the RNA sequence into protein coding sequence. Okay, somehow I have to reach here.
It looks like a nucleotide
protein. This next step, the logical step is the protein. So this is the protein sequence. The seventh step,
convert the nucleotide data.
So first of all, you take the RNA reads, assemble them, and then create a small transcript, which is assembled transcript, and this transcript you further translate and get a protein sequence. Okay. So I have now come to this level, that is the protein sequence over here. Then my standard pipeline, that is my bread and butter, take the mass spec data, take the search engine, multiple search engine, OMSAT and MDM here, and then identify the peptides from there and search in this search space and identify the peptides and take it to protein.
So, one question is that, like, is many of the proteins that we just made synthesis are basically inactive. And that's another thing, get phosphorylated or acetylated.
Biologically, you're talking about the activity or the function, right?
Activity. Those are the things that which are usually seen, which is actually picked up in the mass spec or something like that. So, that's what you call it as a PTM.
PTM, post-translational
modification. So it's more about talking about the phosphoproteomics, or it is basically like all these translated proteomics, or it's just...
So there are a couple of things now you have used in this question. One is phosphoproteomics, as Sriram just now wrote, is actually nothing but enriching your data set for phosphorylated proteins. That is a field in itself in the proteomics field, that phosphoproteomics, that you are looking for phosphorylated proteins. Here, no such attempt was made that I will only look for phosphorylated protein. We will look for all proteins, irrespective of this phosphorylated or glycosylated or whatever the status may be. But we will keep all the modification channel open, as if each of these amino acids got modified. So we are prepared. So for me, there are not 20 amino acids. For me, there are maybe 60 amino acids, 80 amino acids. Each amino acid native and its phosphorylated status, its glycosylated status, if it is glycosylable or if it is phosphorylable. So that way we have created a series of masses, and we do a lot of combination to explain this spectra. This spectra need to be explained. Whatever may be the combination of amino acids, we need to explain this. Okay? Now, in the previous slide, I told you about multiple search engine. Now, multiple search engine sometimes land you up in this kind of problem. What is this problem?
Solutions.
Multiple opinions. Each of the search engine is giving you a different set of results. Now, how do you deal with this situation? As you students have to give me a way out. Then only I will know that it is a participatory talk. Otherwise, it will be a monologue. There are multiple search engines, and each of them are giving you different set of.
Suppose it depends on the pipeline which we are taking into consideration, like which parameters are important for us. So we take those parameters and whatever data we have.
So level playing field has been given to all of the search engines,
okay.
But their results are different. Now it is a thought process I am invoking in you, because if I give you the answer, then you know you may think that is very trivial. But if you do a 1 minute thinking, what comes to your mind first?
The data that is common.
Common. Right. So exactly that's what we did. Data that is common to two or more algorithms, took it. We took it, went ahead. But with a pinch of salt. What if two of them are equally wrong? Two algorithms can be equally wrong. Possibilities are there. And there could be one algorithm which is correct, but nobody else has picked up. That is more a loss for me, because the experimental sample data were more precious, and we could not lose that kind of identification. So losing this 746, 1104, 222, 436 is like a lot of heavy loss we are having over here. So, we have to now find out a method in which we can re-evaluate all our findings. Okay? And to do that, we have to take shelter of a method which actually tells you that calculate the FDR, false discovery rate, of your finding. So, each of the method will have their own FDRs for discovery rate, and we have to somehow bring them together to a single FDR parameter. Okay, so what is FDR? For discovery rate, which is what? cost discovery rate is very simply explained over here. When you take the experimental space, search in a theoretical space, then you get a score distribution. Okay, so some spectra are qualified at a very low score. Qualified means they got a very low score, and some spectra got very good score. Now my job is to tell that where should I put the pass mark. Okay, so what we did, we created a decoy database. What is a decoy database? A fictitious database, a spurious database. There is no such protein sequence in that organism, but then they look like amino acids. So what we do, we read the amino acids in a jumbled up way from right to left in a random fashion. So composition remaining the same, but we create theoretical proteins which is not the actual protein. They look alike, but they are not the same. And then when you start searching the experimental data in that database, then you get a random score. By random chance, you will get some score. Because if there are 10 peaks over here, 3 peaks will match. 4 peaks will match. Then 4 peaks will give you a score. So that is a random score.
The decoy is similar to target in terms of their length and composition.
Right, but not identical. No single peptide you will find shared between the two. ABCD, if it is the answer, the ABCD will not find over here. But you will get BACD, you will get anything else.
Sorry?
No, just calling it a randomized. So typically what we do is we read it from right to left like we do. So most of the things are taken care of. But you can really do randomization, you can do any other thing. Lot of things people take into account, that the composition, the length, they are all comparable. So that nobody say that now we have made a database which is more protein rich, more something else rich. So that is not the case. We keep the amino acid composition same and the length similar to arrive at the level later. And then we draw a threshold. So is this threshold correct, students? Yes or no? And if this threshold is correct, then what is the FDR of our finding? Bolo, jo se bolo. Galti ho sakta hai na?
50%
of the FDR. Anybody else who is disagreeing with him? It's actually 0% FDR.
So
you're
not getting anything false.
There is no red zone.
As above that
line. Always. When you give a threshold like that, it's obvious. So all our findings are pure. Good. So 0% FDR. But too lavish. I mean, I am losing many peptides at the borderline zone and can't be, bioinformatician cannot be so lavish because experimentalists have done a lot of hard work. So we have to work hard to give them the better. So what we do, we reduce the threshold to an extent that we allow only 1% false discovery rate. So the ratio of the red to green is 1%. That is a common acceptable parameter. So FDR simply, if you take it as, it's a decoy to target ratio. But that is where you do a search which is separate, two different databases. However, if you do the search in a single database, that is a concatenated database, then you have to revise the formula, which is 2 into decoy divided by target plus decoy, because in a single database, you one decoy kills another search green peptides chances of being qualified. So that's how in a concentrated score, this is how the FDR is calculated. Okay.
So how did that formula came up for the concatenated database?
For the concatenated database, imagine a single database which has got the red peptides as well as the green peptides. The highest scoring peptide, if it is red, then you don't get a green peptide at all. So that has killed the chance of a green peptide. In this case, however, you got a green peptide and you also got a red peptide because two are two different details. So the decoy is simple ratio, FDR is simple ratio of decoy to target. But here, you actually, every decoy kills the chance of another score of a green. So that's how 2 into decoy divided by target plus decoy. So to, the space of the search, search space total is in the denominator. Then the next interesting point is, I told you that four different search engines will give you four different results. How do I find out a new method, new matrix of comparing them? Somebody is coming to you with, sir, I am first division or I am having 90%. Another person is coming, I am having A grade. Another person is coming and saying that something else, CGPA or whatever. And then these are three different toppers from three different boards, and the admission committee is breaking their head. How do I now compare them to whom? So they somehow find out a relationship. Okay, we will take 80% as this grade and that 90% is that grade, and they do it. So in this case, we have to do it in a fashion that I am going to say, tell to you. This is what we do. Supposing score and p-value are two different metrics. I probably showed in the slide but forgot to tell you. Different search engines give you different metrics. Like somebody is giving you e-value, p-value and score. So now, higher the score, better is the finding. But in e-value, p-value, lower the e-value, p-value, better is the finding. In BLAST, you would have seen lower p-values are better or e-values are better. So what we do, we simply plot the FDR, and the FDR looks like this. You know why? Because as you lower the score, then you start hitting a red. The moment you hit a red, the FDR shoots up. First red hit comes, the false discovery rate has shut off. But then, while on that red, you start getting green after green after green after green. So FDR is nothing but decoy by target. Okay. So as you start getting more and more target, the FDR reduces. Then you hit another red. That goes up. Then you start getting green, it goes down. Now the FDR curve looks like this. Okay. And if I give a cutoff like this, if I give a FDR cutoff like this, then all these green peptides will be disqualified. The green peptides are very late and they all of them are getting disqualified. Although all these green peptides are coming at the same red zone, same red score, they are coming, but they are getting penalized. If I set this as the cutoff, okay, then this gets qualified, all of them gets qualified, but the FDR is very low. Spuriously, the FDR comes low. How can I reduce the score and my FDR also reduces? FDR to badhna chahiye. How can I reduce? So what we did? We drew another line and we call it as Q value, quality value. Quality value tells that if the FDR is this much, then all of them are equal. This qualifies with the same rank, this qualifies at the same rank, all of them. Because anyway, at this level, you have qualified this guy, this red guy, as well as you have qualified all these green guys. So let us set the threshold like this. And the problem was each of these green peptides complained, saying that how can I be same as this guy? I am having better score, this guy is having better score is increasing in this axis, and this guy is having lower score. You are telling me all of us equal? Not acceptable. I hope you are with me. So the next was, we created a simple linear regression between the points of this thing, and we call it as FDR score. This is a published method. When I say we, the credit goes to A.R. Jones, and we have converted his thought process in publication into our tool package. So now this looks more promising. The score is reducing, the FDR score is increasing in a linear fashion between this point and this point. So wherever I give a cutoff, I then qualify all the peptides having better score and all reject all the peptides having lower score. Got it? Now, this whatever I explained you for score, they also happen to be applicable to p-value, because all of them behave. You may ask this question, do they really behave the same way? So here is two different examples, I am sorry. This is real data. The previous one I showed you was a simulated data, when I was cartooning the presentation. This is a real data. So as you see, as the score is reducing, I am getting the red one, more or less similar the way I have shown in the cartooning form. And then we created the green line, and then we got a FDR score. This is for the score, the search engine that gives you score. But when you took another search engine which gives you Q value, that also behaved the similar way. Although the slope is different, but that also behaved the similar way. So we got a green line. Now, based on this, we created a new FDR score as a metric and created that as a cutoff. So that's all about multiple search engine and combining the results from multiple search engine, creating a new matrix, and based on the new matrix, increasing the confidence of your finding. If you have increased your confidence of finding, then whatever your result, what you report, happens to be correct. So let's now come back to the original problem we left. We have come to find out the human missing protein. And for the missing protein, this is what we have with us. All of them are freely available. Millions of dollars worth of data available on the internet. It is equally available to you also. I'm trying to tell you, student, that doing science these days has become easier. All you need to have a good question, lots of data available, and computer and some idea. So different tissue types, colon, lung, mononuclear cells, testicular matrix, lung, fetal, brain, all these things data, tissue type, and this is the number of spectra. As you can see, all of them, if you add up, it's in millions, nearly 2 million of spectra. Okay? And this, there is a database called Thrive. If you go to Thrive database, you can download all of them. It is yours. And then, this I already had explained to you. This is my search strategy. Input data, you got it from public repository. All these strategies we have made. Now, we have already identified Nextprot as a database of choice. I told you that. And we have already created translated protein sequence using that framework. Using this FastQC, Trimomatic, OTA, IROFAT, Fasting, Performance, all these things. Now everything is ready. What is needed is the results. So what we reported is in front of you. We got, after doing all this exercise, we got nearly 28 missing proteins we have. So in the beginning of the slide, you remember I had shown you that there are only 18 people have found and we have reported 28. The moment we said 28, many eyebrows raised. How can you say 28 proteins you have got? So what happened is that each of these identification had to go through now manual curation process, and it has gone through that manual curation. I am reporting you after the manual curation process. So 22 of them we reported from the transcript level evidence, PE2. One of them we got the PE4, and 5 of them we got from PE5, the last category. So we got that. All of them finally did not get published because the reviewer did not accept this type. They said they want more experimental evidence than computational evidence. But nonetheless, we could publish the rest of our finding, and the result is there in front of you. Some of the missing proteins we got are having these genes. They are in the transmembrane domain. Many of them are in transmembrane domain. They are having a signal peptides. They are in different important pathways, for example, secretory pathways, some of them, the mitochondria, and all these things are there. Their protein name, functional annotation, the way a bioinformatician, however they do, we have also identified their function computationally, and their location, which chromosome they are located. All these things we have done and reported in this paper. This is a published paper, you can go and have a look at it. What is interesting, most interesting of doing research is this. What is the fate of your identified protein? You got some proteins, whether people are referring to it, people are getting benefit out of it. You can see lots of publication that has come, which is talking about the same protein I shown in the previous one. Having cell research, Journal of Neuroscience, Biochemistry, Journal of Stroke, and Cerebrovascular Disease. So all these papers have come out which are talking about those genes. And few genes which did not get updated into the database because of the review process and all these things. Those are but also getting cited. And I'm trying to suggest to the student community that it's not that if your findings are always published or not published, because there is a reviewer, couple of reviewers, they may agree, they may not agree. But if you always create your own repository or a blog or something, you say that okay, these are the proteins I had also reported. They are there. And others, these people are not bioinformaticians. They have nothing to do with human missing protein also. They are simply working on their area of interest and they happen to land up on the proteins that we are talking about.
So, is there a trend like from your data, from what you have shown us, that it's mostly a neuronal protein, first of all. Secondly, it's always most of the proteins are having only the P on something.
Yes, I can see that.
Most of them are in the P on something.
That is a good observation. I saw some Q, but then most of them are P, as you said correctly.
And most of them are secretly culture, which you must have already observed.
Oh, that's right. Most of them are expected to be either secretory pathway or olfactory pathway. These are the ones, membrane protein, these are the ones which actually are neglected in the previous studies and all. That's why.
Most importantly, it is the type of cells that which are actually. Yes. Most of them are neuronal cells which are.
Maybe that is dependent on the data set that we are analyzing. We got data set from this. We did not get data set from other cell types and tissue types.
So that might be the
so our input layer somewhere fixes us where the output would go. So though I got some fetal brain, fetal liver, but the expectation is that more of disease conditions or fetal conditions will give more missing proteins into our repertoire. So, I think I am towards the end of this. So, current story, maybe a month before. This is the level of evidence. Nothing much has happened beyond this. We have got, these are the statistics of the discipline. The message that I would like to pass on to students are this. The money spent on this is negligible. The question, data available on the internet, computers already there, methods homegrown, and so many of these tools in between codes are either taken from already published literature and we created our own, including our small factors that our FDR correction and all this thing. So, a computational biologist would not remain hungry in the current day. If you have a good internet connection, if you have a decent enough computing facility, and questions are always waiting for computational biologist's attention, and you can contribute in some form or the other. So that's all. In this journey, we have generated several tools, MassWiz in the search engine, like OMSAN Tandem. This one is coded in Perl, happens to be slower than the competitors like OMSAN Tandem. So people do not prefer, but this is very accurate. Flexi FDR, the way we calculate FDR, has been dealt here. ProteoStat is a lot of a library of programs, small snippets that have been given for analyzing mass spec data. Genosuit is entire end-to-end pipeline, which identifies through proteogenomic approach the genes, the novel genes. And we are in the process of making proteome analysis. Nice looking GUI based tool which could help the biologist who do not want to do a lot of command line based programming. For them, this is in the process. People who have contributed, this, although there are many names have been seen, shown over here, I would like to draw your attention to this girl. She came to me for a 6-month training, Aradhya Jain, who is the first author of this paper, Missing Protein Protein in JPI. So it is she who I thought busy rakhna hai, kuch kaam de dete hain, missing protein ka kaam de diya. But then this girl was highly focused, and you know, her English was good. She converted entire of her work in such a way, a report, and it could be converted into a paper. Dhirendra is a PhD student who is now in NIH, US. So he supervised this girl in terms of accuracy and teaching her how to do things. And rest of the people have contributed some or the other in the mastery development, like safety, all these things, which I did not present today to you. So, but anyway, all of them have contributed my proteomics journey. So, thank you for your kind attention, and I am ready for questions.
Thank you. So, any more questions, or would you like to discuss at any time? Okay. Right, so thank you. Thanks a lot, Devashish, for invoking us into this new topic of finding missing genes and giving it in a manner so that students get inspired by. For asking good questions and with the available resources. Thank you, thanks a lot. So this is from us. Everybody can at least take a t-shirt.
Thank you, thank you.